Board.
This meeting is being
Let's do that recorded. Now. Very good. Thank you, Zoom. So, active listening in a noisy world. Let's jump in, guys. You know I'm teaching all of this stuff all around the world. When you talk, you are only repeating what you already know. If you listen, you learn something new. So, in other words, we're born with two ears and one mouth. So we should listen twice as much as we talk. When we're talking, we're just repeating stuff that is already known to us. Now, this might seem a little bit obvious, yet it is especially important in the context for leadership. You see, old school leadership is, you know, do as you say, do as you're told, do what I tell you to do, do this and do that. And in that leadership function, if we're only telling our teams what to do, then they are going to be limited to our level of consciousness or our level of awareness. A true collaborative team is a team in which there is a psychologically safe environment, right? In other words, an environment that it is encouraged for people to speak up and share their ideas, to ask questions, to raise concerns, or maybe even admit mistakes. It's only then when you really encourage other people to talk and to share and ask those questions that we can evolve together as a group in your team, right? Whether it's your business or your family or whoever it is. If we're only telling people, we've capped our growth, we've capped our kind of consciousness at that level. As we open up to listen to other people, more creativity, more solutions, more identified potential problems so that you can prevent problems even before they happen. Cool. I saw the chat box flinking at me now. We've got Pakistan, we've got KL, we've got Bangkok all over. So why are listening skills important, guys? It's an opportunity to learn something new. Think about it. Every course that you've been to, every training that you've attended, every audio book that you've listened to, everything that you've learned is listening, not just with the ears, right? We're talking about bringing information here through all of your senses. So that's the opportunity to learn something new. If we walk around covering our ears and covering our eyes, then again, we are going to stagnate, we're going to plateau, and we won't grow to that next level. Listening skills are important because it shows respect for the person that you're communicating to. I've been doing these webinars. We've got these free webinars here, which are awesome. I love our little community. And this is my life now, doing leadership and coaching webinars in a virtual world with organizations all over the world. You know, one of the things that really, really annoys me when we're working with leadership, like senior leaders who are looking to develop their teams, you know how they run their meetings, guys, in their companies? They do it like this. So imagine this for a moment. Hey, team, good morning. How are you guys doing? Did you have a good weekend? Yeah, me too. Where is this, right? Where is this? So if you're a leader in an organization, or for the love of God, please keep your camera turned on, because you're not just listening with your ears. And I'm going to show you some statistics in a moment. Keep the camera turned on because it shows a mutual respect. Right now, I know that sometimes the Wi-Fi or the bandwidth is dodgy and you need to shut off the camera so you can still hear them, or the cat just chewed through the camera cable. I get it. But for 95% of the time, you want to keep your cameras turned on because it shows respect for the person that you're communicating to. Now, I'm not fussy here today, guys. You can leave your camera on however you want to do it. You can turn it off. That's okay. This is not a judgment. What I'm saying is, if you want to effectively lead your team, if you want to connect with your customers and your clients, if you want the project success with these different stakeholders, then keep your camera turned on. And if it's with your team, encourage them to keep their cameras turned on as well. It just shows a higher level of respect when you're listening with the whole package, not just your ears. Next one, develops greater creativity, right? As you're learning something new, as people contribute, as you create this safe space that allows people to ask questions and share concerns, well, as the leader, you are getting more pieces of data and information. And as you gather these extra pieces of data and information, because you're a good listener, well, oftentimes a creative idea or a solution or an innovation, it's not just a standalone, ta-da. It is often a little piece of that combined with a little piece of that combined with a little piece of that mixed together gives you that creative juice, gives you that innovation, gives you that solution to that ongoing problem. So as you can listen and receive all of those little clues, those little nuggets of gold, you're able to put it together into an awesome solution. With that, you can prevent problems and drama before they happen. Prevention is better than cure, or you can actually solve a problem if you're in the middle of it. Tell me, guys, pop it into the chat box, please. Tell me why are listening skills important? Pop it into the chat box there nice and quickly. Tell me why do you think listening skills are important, please. Pop your answers there. Any answers, good, bad, anything is good. As you're doing that, I'll share a couple of more. Listening skills are important because it builds better relationships, better synergy, collaboration, and alignment. Yeah. Oh, wow. The chat box is firing up here now. Let's have a look. sorry, I'm in the gym. All right. Oh, we've got someone doing a workout and feeding their brain. I love it. So yes, build rapport, avoid quick conclusion, pay respect to the others, stay focused so people feel heard. One of the best gifts that you can give another human being is that sense that they feel heard, that they feel appreciated. That is massively going to deepen and develop the rapport. To deliver the result, yes. Trust building to connect, right? Sense of belonging from the participants. You'll understand others better. Listening is learning. Learning is showing respect and humility. Oh, well, knowing each other, understanding the others. Spot on, guys, spot on. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yeah, it allows others to express themselves safely. So psychological safety, it's a new-ish concept. It's actually been around for about 20 years, but it's only hit the mainstream kind of leadership circles in the last year or two. Psychological safety is a belief that one will not be punished or humiliated for speaking up with ideas, questions, concerns, or mistakes. So in other words, as a leader, guys, remember my focus is leadership and coaching, right? So in the leadership context, which is your self-leadership as well, could be with your family, you want to create a safe environment that allows your team, that encourages your team to voice it out, to speak up, to share that, oh, boss, what about this thing that we've not considered yet? So by doing so, by being open to listen to all of this data, you're going to make more empowered decisions. Build better empathy. Develop deeper rapport for greater influence, right? So rapport is trust and connection. Why do we want to build more rapport, guys? Because you want to be able to influence the world around you, your world, not necessarily the world. We can't influence the governments right now, certainly not at my pay grade. So we can't control the lockdowns. We can't control the pharmaceutical industry. We can't control the reactions to what's going on at the moment. What we can control is our little universe. The people that you care about, your family, your co-workers, your customers, your suppliers, your vendors, whoever is in your little universe, you can influence, right? You can influence them. So by deepening the rapport, by listening attentively and carefully, it enables you, it empowers you to be able to influence your world, your little universe, towards a win-win, whatever that might be for you. Active listening definition. Active listening is the ability to focus completely on a speaker, whoever that speaker is, to understand their message, to comprehend the information, and to respond thoughtfully, right? So it really is taking communication into a two-way process, yeah? I like to think of active listening is involving listening with all of the senses. Now, let's take a look here. There are four elements for your active listening skills. So when we say we can use all of the senses, body language is part of that. Now, I know a few of you know the answer to this question that I'm about to ask. What percentage of our communication, guys, is via our body language? What percentage of our communication is via our body language? What's the answer? Put the answer into the chat box, please. What percentage of our... Oh, nice. Look at that. Yes, very good. Very good. Excellent. Very good. Awesome. Awesome. Very good, guys. Now, the correct answer is 55%. Right? Now, that's a lot. That's a lot of information that's just being conveyed by the way that I use my body, my posture, my gestures, my facial expressions, right? My eye contact. Is it creepy or is it just the right balance, right? Even breathing to an advanced level. Now, this is why I was saying to my wonderful leadership students today, you wonder why you're having so much challenge to influence your team. You wonder why your turnover is so high. You wonder why it's hard to get the team motivated. Well, it's difficult because they're running their meetings like this and they're turning their cameras off and they're trying to influence their team and no one can see them. And because the boss has their camera off, everyone else turns their camera off. So now you have halved the amount of influence you have by having a two-way conversation. In fact, statistically, if two people have their camera off, I don't know what makes that. Who's good at numbers? Maybe it's only now you're left with 25% if both people do it both ways, because now you've only got the tonality and you've only got the words, which leaves a lot of room for miscommunication and misunderstanding. So one thing is for sure, guys, whether you know it or not, you are influencing the world around you via your body language. So we either do it consciously or we do it unconsciously. So for example, let's imagine for a moment that I'm the leader and you guys are my team, all right? And let's imagine it's Monday morning and I'm coming into the office, which can be face-to-face or virtual, it doesn't matter. Now imagine this, and I come into the office like this. Nah, you ready? Now, put in one word. I didn't say anything. Put in one word in the chat box. What do you read? What do you hear from my body language just now in this little exercise? Put it into the chat box. Discouraged. What the hell? Yeah. What the? Right? Give me some more. Give me some more. What else do you interpret or do you read? Bad news, tired, exhausted. What else might it mean? Give me some more. Yeah, Monday already. I'm disappointed. I'm tired. Yeah, I don't want to join. Oh, back to work. Screw this. Screw you. That's exactly what I'm saying. Remember, if I'm the leader and I'm turning up to work like that on a Monday, what I'm kind of saying is, you know what, team? I don't really care about you. My drama and my self-importance is more important than all the rest of you. So whether we are conscious of it or not, our teams are always looking at us. They're always listening, not just to the words. They are watching our body language, because our body language is communicating 55% of whatever we're thinking and whatever we're feeling. That combination of our emotional state, we're projecting via our body language, right? So again, Be mindful of your own body language, and please, with your teams, do your best to keep your camera turned on for your meetings and insist that they do the same as well. Next, guys, is what? Tonality. Who knows the answer? What percentage of our communication is via our tonality, the tone of our voice, the tempo, how quickly we talk, the volume of our voice? Who knows the percentage? So I'll give you a clue. It's somewhere between 1 and 100. 35 to 40, 40, 40. What else have we got? 35, 20, 38, 25. Nice. 38, very good. The correct answer is 38. I can see we have some people familiar with NLP in the class today. That's wonderful. So yeah, tonality is also quite important, right? Gentlemen, try this tonight. Say to your wife, I love you, right? And see how she responds with that tonality. She'll be like, what? But I said the words. No. The tonality was not there. So again, we're listening with the whole spectrum of our senses. The tonality gives a certain feeling behind the words. The physiology is what you see right in front of you. Now, who is good at math? Who is good at math? What is the remaining percentage, please? Who knows what it is? That's right. 7%, right? So 7%, only 7% are the words that we use. So we talk about active listening, and I'm sure you've heard the concept of active listening, which is simply to repeat back your understanding to ensure correct understanding, but that's only 7%. So to take your active listening to a whole nother level is to include all of your senses, the body language, the tonality, and the actual words that people are using. A combination of all of that, as you are connecting with this human being that you're communicating with, you're also getting a sense of their emotional state, right? What emotional state are they in right now? Right? What do we call that? We call that empathy. Empathy is being able to appreciate the current emotional state of another person. And that's taking your listening to a whole nother level, because you're including all of these elements and their emotional state, right? Think about it. Depending on their emotional state will help determine how you are going to communicate with them. Right? A quick example. Many years ago, I went to Tokyo, and it was my first time to Tokyo, and it was my first time doing a training in Tokyo. It was an executive leadership program. And I started the training, and I'm doing the thing that I do. I'm talking loud, I'm rah, rah, rah. I'm 2 meters tall, if you can't tell. And we're in this little room, and there are these amazing leaders all from Japan. And as I'm talking, I'm looking at the audience. I was active listening by looking at the audience. I was kind of calibrating and watching their actions and their reactions. And I was like, it was like they were scared, right? The people were looking away. Their eyes were looking down. There was a gentleman at the front row. Anytime I looked at him, he looked away like this. And I looked around and I looked back to him. And then he looked away like this. And I thought, whoa. These guys don't feel safe. I have not built rapport with them. I've just been busy doing my thing without really checking in with the audience to see where they're at. So what did I do? I took a couple of steps back. I lowered the volume of my voice. I softened the tonality. I changed my training style. I told some stories. I helped to create a safe environment. They had no idea who I was. I'm just a 2-meter kangaroo for all they know. So as I connected with them as human beings and I told them these stories and I adjusted my communication style to match them. There's no right or wrong. They just had a softer, more calm, kind of personality and communication style. So it was up to me to adjust to that, to match them where they were at in order to build that rapport, that trust, and that safety. Then, as they began to engage with me, they would look at my eyes, they wouldn't run away. Then, of course, I was able to pick the tempo up so I could get them more motivated to do the work that they needed to do, which was a strategic plan for the next 5 years. Does that make sense, guys? Yeah. So you're listening to the whole package, the whole package. Right. So here is, what's his name? Obama. That's how you could potentially read his body language. And here are the same emotions with this guy. Okay, that's a bad joke. All right, that's a bad joke. But how are we going for time? I would like to do a quick little exercise. I need one volunteer, please. Who would like to volunteer right now? I need a volunteer who would like to turn their camera on and who would like to volunteer. We're going to do a little practice session right here, right now, about active listening using somebody's face. Who would like to volunteer? Put your hand up or unmute yourself. Me, Corinna says me. Where are you, Corinna? Talk to me, talk to me. Where are
Hi.
You? Hey, there you are. Okay. So guys, as you're watching there, you can pin Karina's video so we can see her face nice and clearly, all right? Now, we're going to do this little exercise. It's basically a tool of awareness to be a little bit more aware about what someone's going on with their physiology and what's going on inside, and particularly with their emotional state, all right? So is it Karina? Do I pronounce correctly?
Karina.
Karina, sorry, Karina. Thank you very much. So, Karina, what I'd like you to do, we're going to do this little exercise, but I need to calibrate a little bit first. I need to be a little bit, I need to get to know you a little bit. So I'm going to ask you a question and just imagine it's just you and me. Okay, Karina, just you and me. No one else is here. Huh? Gotcha. And so as you're sitting there, just kind of take a breath and relax. And you can do this with your eyes open or your eyes closed, however you feel most comfortable. And what I'd like you to do as you're sitting there now, just think of someone that you really, really like. Just think of someone that you really, okay, all right. Okay, very good, very good. Excellent. Now shake it out a little bit, Karina. Shake it out a little bit.
All right.
So now, Karina, I'd like you to think of someone that you really, really don't like. Someone you really, really don't like. Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. All right, shake it out. So now, Karina, what I want you to do is not to tell us, but I want you to think of either someone you really, really like or someone you really, really don't like, and just hold that for a couple of seconds. Do that now. Okay, very good. Tell me, guys, in the chat box or shake your head, doesn't like or does like? What do you think? I think the dislikes have it there, Karina. Are we right? Is that, yep. We're correct. Okay, very good. All right, now we'll do it again. All right, remember, don't tell us, okay? So shake it out. So now, Karina, I'd like you to think of someone you really, really like or someone you really, really don't like. Interesting. What do you think, guys? Was it like or don't like? Yeah, it's a tough one. Let's get a few more answers, guys. Tell me what you think. My hallucination, right? Because the thing is, we don't really know, right, guys? Then this is why body language is so important. My hallucination is that she was thinking of someone that she did like, but she was trying to hide it, but I don't know. So because we don't know, okay, let's ask her. Was it someone you like or someone you don't like?
Exactly. It was somebody I like, but I was trying to play the thing.
Very good. Very good. All right. Gold star for Luke. All right. One more time. All right. Shake it out. So now, Karina, go ahead and think of someone that you really, really like or someone that you really, really don't like. Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. All right, hold it there. Someone said hate. Maybe that's a strong word. Someone you like or did not like?
Don't like.
Okay, very good. Okay, guys, now, first of all, give her a round of applause for volunteering in front of 30 strangers. That's amazing. Now, who can tell me, guys, pop it into the chat box right now. What was it that you noticed that was different? Right, now, remember, we did calibrate first. So we did notice some things about versus like to don't like, but then when she did not tell us, there were still a couple of little clues there. So what do we got? Okay. So eyes, the lip line. Yeah. Anything else, guys? Anything else? Yeah, there was a little sway of the body language here. There was a little bit of a, almost like a with the don't like person, the shoulders dropped a little bit, right? Now, here's the thing with using your awareness, right? And in the world of NLP, we call this sensory acuity. And so with sensory acuity is we don't always know for sure, right? Especially if we're just meeting a person for the very, very first time. So we need to be mindful. We don't make mind read. We don't make assumptions. We don't try to guess. What we're looking at is those subtle changes that might give us a clue that you're moving into more rapport or that you're having less rapport. In other words, more influence or less influence. Now, in coaching conversations, for those of you who are interested in coaching, well, what it means is that if, for example, you're having a conversation with, and it can be anyone, by the way, not just a coaching client, and they do this. We don't know what it means, but we know something just happened in the mind of that other person. Something shifted. You asked a question or they responded somehow and they followed with a, So we don't know, but it is certainly a clue because we're listening to the whole package. It gives us a clue to ask a follow-up question, such as, hey, I just observed a deep exhale now. What does that mean? Right? Because we don't want to mind read. We don't want to guess. Now, if you do know someone very, very well, because you have calibrated them a lot of times, you will get a sense that if this happens, then that perhaps means they're feeling a certain way. But for sure, we don't want to get caught up in a mind read or a guess or an assumption. All right. Well, that was fun. Thanks, Karina. I really appreciate that. All right. No, I won't say that joke because I don't know everybody's nationalities. All right. Moving on, a great, great tool to improve listening with your teams, with your clients, with your family, with your teenage children. This tool is so simple, so profound, so effective. Hang on, guys, to this. It's called Clarify and Verify, which is an extended version of active listening. So Clarify, Verify is a very, very simple language pattern to create clarity and to remove those assumptions, to remove that mind read and that guessing. It eliminates misunderstandings that arise from the mind reading or the assumptions or the guessing. It prevents drama and mistakes and conflict. And this is so simple. It is so easy. Basically, when someone is communicating to you, you simply repeat back one of these phrases. May I clarify and verify my understanding, please? Da, 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 da. And then you just repeat back what you heard. Or if I understand correctly, da, 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 and you're repeating back what the person just said to you. What I'm hearing is da, 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 da. Now, you've all had this experience before. Remember when you went to the restaurant and maybe there was a big group of you and everyone made their order. And at the end, the waiter or the waitress said, may I repeat your order, please? And you kind of automatically breathe a sigh of relief because they read it back and they got it right. So you know that the food that it's about to come is going to be A-OK. It's going to be what you ordered. right? But when the waiter does not read back your order, chances are something's going to be wrong, or they'll forget something, or they'll deliver something wrong. So you already know how to do this. You've already done it before. May I repeat my understanding? I'm sorry, I don't understand. Can you say that again? Can you repeat that, please? My understanding is. So play around with these and use the one that works best for you. Try them differently. And when you're using it, guys, there's actually two ways, right? So in addition to these little sample scripts here, you have the option to be a mirror and repeat back word for word exactly what the person talking to you says. So whatever they say, you just repeat it back word for word, right? So if I understand correctly, is that correct? Now, the beautiful thing with this technique is there's only two things that can happen. And they're two awesome things, by the way. The first thing that can happen is the person communicating to you says, uh-huh, yep, yep, that's what I said, yep. Or they'll say something like, well, what I meant to say is, da, 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 da. And then they will clarify what they meant to say, what they were trying to communicate, especially the meaning of what they were trying to communicate. Oftentimes, people out there, they operate at the surface level of language, and miscommunication happens because they think that you think the same way that they think. So as a result, they're only kind of giving like part of the information or half the information because they think that everyone in the world thinks the same way that they think, which we know is not true. So you can repeat back word for word like a mirror. That can be very, very useful in coaching conversations or with your subordinates. Because as you act as the mirror, their own language is bouncing back to them. And so if they keep saying to themselves, what I meant to say was, or what I meant to say was, what I meant to say was, eventually that's going to create the awareness that, they need to work on being more articulate, more expressive, more clear in their communication, right? The other way to practice this is by paraphrasing, right? So someone says blah, 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 and then you can say, well, what I'm hearing is da, 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 da. So you can take whatever they say and you can shorten it down to kind of digest it in a meaning that makes sense to you. Either way, they're going to say, yep, that's what I meant, or they'll say, yes, yes, that's what I meant to say. Thank you. So play around with both, right? Play around with being the mirror, play around with doing the paraphrasing, see what works best for you, depending on your audience, right? Depending on who you're communicating with. The beauty of this little tool here is you can also do it when delegating, right? So when you're giving instructions to your team, to your kids, to your whoever, you can check back on their understanding. So can you kindly repeat back your understanding? Can you please summarize the key points? Please clarify and verify your understanding. Please share your understanding, right? So however you want to use it, guys, whether you're receiving information or you're delivering information, you're taking the listening to a whole other level. And by the way, if you want to practice this with your team and you want to be able to implement it without resistance, try this. Next time you have a team meeting, you say to your team, hey, team, thanks for being here. Thanks for keeping your cameras on, team. Awesome. Great to see everyone. Listen, team, I would love to improve my communication. As a leader, I think I always have room to grow and improve, and I would like to practice better communication. And so what I'd like to do, team, with your support and with your permission, is that we practice a technique called clarify, verify, so that I can improve my communication, right? And then you just teach them this, right? You can take a screenshot now, you can catch it on YouTube later. Here are the examples, really, really easy. And then you just start practicing that within your team. And what everyone will see is the huge amount of benefits and the lesser amount of drama. So in other words, everything improves inside of the team. And then you've created a very strong communication habit within your team. right? So in other words, you own it to say that you want to improve. Don't go into your team and say, listen, team, your communication sucks. We're going to practice this module now. Please, please don't deliver a message like that. You'll get a high level of resistance, I am sure. So in addition to what we've learned so far about listening with all of our senses, including the empathy and emotion, by kind of, you know, calibrating and taking those measurements of people when you're speaking with them, not at them, right? You're speaking with them. And in addition to clarify, verify, this tool is one of my favorites, which I simply call clear expectations. Again, this is really, really good in the leadership environment, and it can be used in the family environment or anywhere else. And a really good time to use this tool is when you kind of feel that there might be a little bit of tension, a little bit of like between you and this other person. So again, it could work really good with subordinates or people working in another division, someone at your same level. It could even be your boss. So most frustration and anger in the workplace happens because people's expectations are not being fulfilled. In other words, I have an expectation of this person and they're not doing it. And I have an expectation of this person, but they're not doing it. And then they have an expectation of me and I'm not doing it. So everyone is walking around kind of mumbling to themselves because no one is fulfilling their expectations to what they expect. Now, the real problem is that they have never taken the time to express those expectations in a clear, mature, and respectful manner. So this little exercise, it's one sentence, can remove all of that kind of that angst and that drama and that kind of vibe of not, you know, collaborating together. So very simply, this is best done in a group of two in a private space. You simply say to your colleague, in my role as whatever your role is, sales manager, marketing director, CEO, whatever it is, in my role as da 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 da, please tell me your expectations of me so that we can create greater synergy. Now, at first, when you say this to the person, because remember, you're leading, right? You're leading this conversation. You're asking them to tell you. So you better make sure with your active listening that you've got your pen and your paper ready, all right? And then whatever they say, you'll listen carefully. You'll write it down. So what I'm hearing is da 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 da. You'll practice, you'll clarify and verify. And then you'll just write down whatever they say. And then you know what you say? Thank you. Now, of course, you want them to reciprocate, right? So you've asked them for their expectations. Well, now the roles are reversed. And then they need to ask you what your expectations are of them. So then they'll swap it around and they'll say, in my role as admin, what is your expectation of me? Then you share, you write them down. They should write them down and they say, thank you. Now, this doesn't necessarily mean sunshine and rainbows overnight. What it does mean, though, it's a starting point to have a mature adult conversation about finding a way forward in alignment and synergy. So, for example, you might have a list of six things from your friend that they just gave you. Three of them, you go, yep, 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 no worries. The other three, you have some concerns about that. So that's when you basically, you kind of start an adult conversation, call it a negotiation if you like, and you might say, hey, listen, Bob, yep, point number one, point number three, and point number four, guarantee I can fulfill those expectations. Number two, though, can we have a discussion about that? I don't feel that I have the resources and I feel it's a little bit outside of my area of responsibility, right? And then so you have a kind of a negotiation. And then by the end of that, however long that conversation takes, you are much more aligned than you were 30 minutes ago. Yeah, and I've used this in my personal life. I've seen executives use this. It never ceases to amaze me, the power of this simple activity. This same group that I was telling you with in Japan. Japan, typically in an organization, is very, very hierarchical. What the boss says goes. No one challenges the boss. Whatever the boss says, that's what they do. Now, we wanted to loosen that up a bit in this strategic planning that we did. So we did this exercise. And you can do it in a room full of people where they do it in a group of two, they write them down, and then they, you know, they do a high five, and they go to the next person and the next person and the next person. What a great way to create alignment at the executive leadership team level. So we did that, and there were about eight people in the room. So everyone got a chance to talk with everyone. And at the end, I said, how was that exercise for you guys? And the deputy managing director, who was the big boss at the time, he put his hand up and I said, yes, sir, how was it? And he said, wow. He said, that was really amazing. He said, I thought that I was really good at delegation. Yet I've just heard, right, because this is a listening tool, guys. I've just heard six people tell me that they want me to delegate more. So he said, team, thank you for bringing this to my attention. I commit to do better at delegating more, right? So a very, very, very powerful exercise creates so much more alignment and synergy and transparency with who's doing what. Does that make sense, guys? Any questions? No? All good? How's my TikTok, TikTok? Awesome. The next thing you want to listen for, guys, is different levels of chunk, right? Different levels of chunk. So what do I mean by that? Some people are very, what we call very, very big picture, right? They're like the visionary. They're talking about, you know, the five-year plan. They're the ones that kind of want to change the world, the big picture. They thrive on things like purpose and why are we doing this and why do we do what we do? And they're, you know, think of, okay, you tell me, who are some people on the planet right now, some famous people who you think might be at this high level of chunk information? They're kind of big chunk, big picture, visionary, driven by purpose. Which people do we know in the media right now that might be operating at this level? Or what typical job function might operate at this level here, guys? Tell me in the chat box, please. Who might that be? Give me some examples, please. Hopefully, the World Health Organization. Fingers crossed on that one. Elon Musk, I would say, is pretty big picture. The Dalai Lama, yep. Yet generally speaking, when we say leaders, Fred, I would say like managing directors, CEOs, people at the executive leadership level. Yeah, the CEO and so on, right? Exactly, guys. So spot on there. They're the kind of people that live at that big chunk. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, we have the detailed kinds of people, the people that really thrive in the details. They love the details, the specifics, the who, the when, the how, and they love talking about the details. Which kind of job function would most people thrive in the details, do you think? Which kinds of people, right? Which kind of job role or function? Scientists, yeah. Programmer, yes. Finance, yeah. Anyone else? Support team, accountants, IT, engineer, yeah. Lawyers or law people, exactly, right? Now, we all have the ability to move through these different levels of chunk. And here's a classic example. Who here you've had to prepare a report and you've had to share that report with the team or the big boss or some kind of presentation. And it might be an Excel spreadsheet or some kind of PowerPoint presentation. There's lots of detail in there. And you have spent weeks preparing this report. You've checked it, you've double checked it, you've had your team check it, you've checked it again on the morning of the presentation, and then you go to your boss and you're feeling kind of proud because you've spent a week putting this report together, and then you give it to your boss, who's typically big picture, right? And the boss looks at it, and almost within a nanosecond, they look at it and they go, this number here, this doesn't look right. And they're right. And you look and you go, how the hell did he spot that? Has anyone had that experience before? I know I have over the years, many, many times, right? So a great leader has the ability to move through these different levels of chunk, right? That you can see the big picture and the way forward and what's happening in the next couple of years. And you can drill down into the specifics when needed. Now, why is this important, guys? Because when people communicate, right, especially with the way that they think, which then relates to the way that they communicate, so their internal communication is a representation of their external communication. So for people who are typically very detailed and very specific, and that's the way they think, well, they're going to use language that is very detailed and very specific, and vice versa for those big picture people. So when you listen carefully to the language that people use, you get a clue whether they're more big picture or whether they're more detailed and more specific. Now, why should that matter, guys? Why should it matter? Why would that be useful to know if someone is big picture or someone is more detailed? Put your answer into the chat box, please. Why would that be useful, do you think? And as you're writing some answers there, if you want to chunk up, you can ask people for what purpose, why, for what's the intention, this is an example of what. So sometimes you need to help people to move through these levels of chunk. Let's take a look at the answers there. To adapt lets you know what they can and can't handle. Tailor your responses to them so you can connect with them. Yep, you are absolutely all spot on. So remember, if we think about rapport, people like people who are like them. So, you know, if you can identify by listening carefully what level chunk someone's chunk is at, then it enables you to connect with them more. It allows you to talk their language, and it enables you to be able to influence them at a higher level. So sometimes if someone's very, very detail oriented, you might need to help them to chunk up into the details. Or vice versa, if you're working with someone who generally lives in the big picture, then they're kind of spending a lot of their time up there, you might need them to chunk down into the details. What specifically, who specifically, when specifically, what do you mean by that? What's an example of that, right? So a lot of miscommunication and frustration occur because people are communicating at different levels of chunk, right? So some people are big picture and some people, their natural tendency might be big picture and detailed. So they could be talking about exactly the same thing, yet because of those different levels of chunk, it results in a miscommunication, frustration, and anger. Quick story, guys. Many years ago, when I first started my career as a professional coach and trainer, I barely knew how to make a PowerPoint. I could do the mechanics of a PowerPoint, but I knew nothing about content and you know, how to deliver a training back in those days. And my business partner at the time, let's call him Bob. Bob was very, very big picture, right? Very, very big picture. In fact, he lived up there most of the time. My preference is probably more into the detail. Yet I have the ability now to move through the spectrum of chunk. So back in these days, this is like 10 plus years ago, we got this new contract to deliver a leadership training. And so I said to Bob, I'm going to help you to build the PowerPoint, but you need to tell me what to put in it because I don't know. I just started working with him. And so I said, what are we going to do? And he says, leadership. Yeah, leadership. I said, yeah, I know that. I said, what specifically, right? So here are some of the questions. I needed, he was living up here. I needed to know the details to build the PowerPoint. And I said, all right. Or I said, okay, Bob, there's the MBTI personality program. This particular client was interested in that. And it was a 2-day leadership program. I said, when would you like the MBTI? On day one or day two? He said, day two. Yeah, I want it on day two. Perfect. So I said, all right, day one, what content do you want on day one? And he's like, well, I want them to be motivated. I want them to be inspired. I want them to improve their communication. Yeah. I said, okay, good. So what do you mean specifically? I said, okay, here. I said, day one, it's split into two chunks. There's before lunch and there's after lunch. What would you like to deliver? What content would you like to deliver before lunch? He said, oh, before lunch. Yeah, okay, yeah, before lunch, I'd like to do da-da-da-da-da. Yeah, I'd like to do that. I said, okay, great. So what I'm doing is I'm taking him from the big picture, which is where he lived. And this is not a judgment or a criticism. That's just where he was. So it was up to me to be flexible in my communication style, to meet him there, to then slowly, because if I jump straight down, what do you want to do at 9:30 a.m. in the morning? He'd be like, well, what? That's too much detail for me. And that would create a miscommunication and a frustration and a conflict between the two of us. Long story short, guys, I was able to, it took about 20 minutes. I was able to slowly bring him down into the chunk levels because guess what? On day one, there's morning and there's afternoon. But then normally in a normal training environment, there's a morning tea break, right? So what do we want before the morning tea break? What do we want after the morning tea break? When we come back from lunch and after the afternoon. So he was able to give me the information that I needed to then go and build those PowerPoints. So chunking is another very, very valuable tool where you can listen very carefully to the language that people use, whether they are big picture or detail, so that you can build more rapport with them, to connect with them, and to be able to influence them at a higher level. And the final little tool, guys, that I want to share with you today that's related to amazing active listening in this noisy world is the NLP Leadership 4-in-1 Certification Program. A lot of these tools that I shared with you today is kind of an overview snapshot of some of the tools that you will learn in the NLP program. Thanks to the Bangkok government lockdown happening right now, we've moved the training down to Pattaya, which will be on the 8th to the 12th of July. You can also join us virtually from anywhere in the world. It's a 5-day program. And of course, we have a very, very special offer for you guys. Or if you'd like to focus more specifically on coaching, where we cover a lot about active listening and listening to the body language and the emotions even more, then the ICF program might be for you. That is available fully online on the 17th and 18th of July. So pretty much your last chance to get in for that. You'll need to go through some pre-study in order to be able to join live virtually on those days. So wonderful, guys. You can join us in November as well. The NLP and ICF training is in November. Fingers crossed they open the borders at, I don't know when. Don't buy any plane tickets just yet, guys. But if you don't want to wait, join us virtually. We'd love to welcome you there. Thank you all so, so much for joining us. It warms my heart to see a few familiar faces here today. So thank you, everyone. Please stay safe. Stay awesome wherever you are in the world. If you would like to join us for one of our programs, let us know and take care, guys. Bye for now. Ciao, ciao.